lesson for last week. Ooh, that just made me louder. Sorry, guys. I just got that on a little better. Okay, and the at-a-glance sheet. And I forgot to pull mine. It's kind of funny because last week when we finished out Timothy, the last thing we did was this at-a-glance sheet. And this week, the first thing we're doing is this at-a-glance sheet. We're not going to get it filled out in its entirety, but that was the last day of your lesson this week, and it had to do with putting that together. So actually, we're going to work on that together. So let us dive right in. There's nothing to review because this is all new to us. And oh, I also want to tell you, at the end of last week, I mentioned maybe doing Mark next, and I looked it up. And Mark looks like it's only 9 lessons, which is actually perfect. It would have us end right at the beginning of May, which is where I always try for us to end, because of school letting out and all that fun stuff. So I really think Mark's going to be next. So just saying, I think that'll be fun. It's always awesome. When we did John years ago, we actually were studying the crucifixion at the same time. It was Easter. And so I can't guarantee that will happen with Mark, but it's always cool to do one of the Gospels about the time you're getting ready to celebrate Easter, just to have the life and ministry of Jesus in the forefront of your mind's cool. So we will probably be doing that, and I will have to get those books ordered soon because Titus is only 3 weeks long. Pretty short. So, okay. Let's do this. Let us read through the first 5 verses of Titus chapter 1. And what we are asking ourselves at the beginning is, what's the historical setting of this book? And when I say historical setting, I mean, like, who's writing it to whom? What can you gather about what was going on in the times? What can you gather about why the letter was written? What the wish of the author was for the recipient, what was the recipient like? So we're thinking about those things, and obviously not all those questions are answered in the first 5 verses, but it sure does help get us started. So here we go. Titus 1, 1 through 5. Paul, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God and the knowledge of the truth, which is according to godliness, in the hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised long ages ago, but at the proper time manifested even his word in the proclamation with which I was entrusted according to the commandment of God our Savior, to Titus, my true child, in a common faith, grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Savior. For this reason I left you in Crete, that you might set in order what remains and appoint elders in every city as I directed you. Okay, super easy first question. Who wrote it?
Paul.
It's almost always right when you're in the New Testament anyways. I mean, if you just play statistics, right? You're probably going to be right. Okay, so we have Paul. What do you know about Paul just from these verses? Just what does it say?
He's a bondservant still.
Bondservant still of
God.
And he's also? An apostle of Jesus Christ. Okay, so we know that much. So we have someone writing the letter who we know really well because we just did 1 and 2 Timothy, but we have Paul writing this letter. Okay, so who is he writing it to?
Titus.
What do you know about Titus?
Your child.
Mom said nothing. He's Paul's true child. How? In the common faith. All right. So we know that much. What else do you might know about Titus? And this has to do with location.
Crete.
What do you know about Crete?
Well, he and Paul were in Crete together at mm-hmm. some point, and Paul left him in Crete.
Paul left him in Crete. Mm-hmm. Where's Crete?
Island.
It's an island where?
South of Greece and Italy.
South of Greece, so in the Mediterranean, south of Greece and Italy. So he left Titus there. Titus has a job. What's Titus's job? As far as Paul's concerned, what's Titus's job?
Putting together the church.
Yeah. Really specifically, go to verse 5, specifically.
He's to finish establishing.
Appoint the elders.
Appoint the elders. I heard that. Sorry, Amy, I did that. I moved this, so it got real loud. Okay. He appointed the elders. Where do those elders go?
In every city.
As? As he's directed. Okay, so you see some subordination. That's not a bad term, right? Or that Titus serves underneath Paul. We see that. And so they are in Crete together. He's supposed to appoint elders in every city on Crete. So Crete is an island, so that makes me think he's visiting little churches in all the little cities, and in those churches he's appointing elders. Step back a little bit, so he appoints elders, but what else is he supposed to do? Set in order what remains. What does that mean? I know, I was thinking about it too, like, so okay, let's do it this. Set in order. What does that mean? What might that mean? To set something in order. What are you doing?
Was to begin organized.
He was supposed to begin organized. Starting stuff. He's supposed to start from point one and go from point one, start setting things in order so that when task one's done, task two can be done, task three. So it's an organization and directional thing that needs to be done.
Mm-hmm. I like, it's what Blanche, I think, took everything you said and made it super simple and just said organizing, right? But yes, I mean, it also sounds like there's tasks.
It sounds like Paul and Titus were together.
Uh-huh.
They were working on something. Paul left and he was saying, mm-hmm. Okay, we established this, but I'm leaving you so that you can continue
yes. To
what already remains and work from there.
Right. I like that. I like that. So he's organizing things. Right? Setting stuff in order, and then he's appointing elders in every city. So that's some historical setting, but let's also, now this wasn't in those five verses that we read, but you, throughout your homework, you read the book like numerous times, did you not? So what do you, so he's telling Titus, I need you to put elders in place, I need you to set in order this church. What did you gather about the conditions of the church? So this has to do with Crete and the churches in Crete. What did you gather about that?
Got some rebellious men.
Got some rebellious men. You find them in verse 10, right? So there's that to deal with. What else do you gather?
Not just rebellious, but there's no organization whatsoever. There's a lack of organization.
There probably is, because there's a lot of time spent on this person needs to be like this, tell these people to do this, tell these people to stop doing this. So you're right. Is there a lack of organization? There are rebellious men in the church. What else?
But there is in verse 6, there's a man that's above reproach with only one wife, so that means that some of the other guys had more than one wife.
Probably. Right. So, okay, so Blanche is bringing us to what might Crete have been like, right? So she's making the assumption that if Titus is being told those elders need to be the husband of just one wife, can it then be true that on that island it was not uncommon for men to have more than one wife? And I would say,
yes, he
wouldn't have to say that, right? So what else do you maybe gather about this church?
I get the sense that Christianity is very, very new to the
yes.
island, and things are just getting started.
Yeah. Baby church, right?
Yeah.
Christianity's new to it. And countercultural.
But most of these early churches are baby churches. But I get the sense that this is all new to the people of Crete.
Yeah. Could very well
do
be.
Do you think there was false teachers?
I do. I believe there's false teachers.
Oh,
I think we see that in chapter 1. We're going to read through it, and I think we see false teachers. Okay, someone, Crystal.
Yes. Is it the Jews that are particularly problematic? He points out those of the circumcision.
Uh huh.
Yes. So I just wondered, is that that maybe the Jewish faith is still really challenging the young Christian church?
Yeah. So you bring up a good point. So and yes, we're going to go there and talk about that. But I'm going to take what you said, and I'm just going to glean some information, just make it really simple. Obviously, there are Jews in the church. Obviously, there are Cretans in the church. There's older men, younger men, older women, younger women. There's also another people group in chapter 2.
Were the Gentiles, too?
Probably Gentiles. And I would probably the Cretans were the Gentiles.
But the children, he was concerned about.
There's children. I'm also thinking of 2:9, slaves. Because he's got some special instructions for slaves. So we've got some of that too. So
Oh,
now you're going beyond me.
Well,
Well, everything's Roman right now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Everything's Roman
okay.
right now.
Okay.
So, but you do see a little bit of racism going on, huh?
Sure.
Right? When you get to 1:9, where is that? It's the Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. That's 1:12, right? So it's a very mixed church. Lots of different things going on. I think that's a pretty great historical overview for us. So on your little at a glance, it's really easy for you to go the author being Paul. And they don't have recipient on there, but I always add it. You've got a historical setting down there. So you can put things on there like Titus is in Crete. Here's what he's supposed to be doing for the church. You know, any observations you make related to them. Let's see. Oh, here's Dad as far as, is the church really new? Just in my leader notes, they wrote, the churches on Crete did not seem to be completely new, but they obviously had not had enough time for elders to be appointed. The society was corrupt with lying, laziness, gluttony, and slavery, as the Roman Empire was in many places. It's like many modern societies. And they make that assumption because of the corrections you hear Paul giving them.
Well, it says in verse 7, it says all of the ones that you shouldn't look at.
Right. So let me say, virtue of the things that he has to address, we know some of the things that might have been going on. Okay, that's historical setting. Now, let us go through it. It's nice and short. So we can start with Titus chapter 1. And we're going to do this thing backwards. Like I said, in Timothy, we did all this at the end, but they have us doing this at the front, so it's kind of fun to see if we can do it. So, chapter 1 is all about what? What's the chapter 1 about? Just really generally speaking.
Organizing the church.
Organizing the church, you could say. Anything else?
Rebellious men.
Rebellious men is this. And what did, I'm sorry, what's that?
Rebellious men must be silenced.
Must be silenced, yeah. So, there you go. You just took us to the chapter title or the chapter theme. That obviously, I think those two elements are the ones about organizing the church, right?
Mm-hmm.
Appointing elders and the rebellious men. So it could be any combination of the two. It could be Titus to appoint elders and reprove rebellious men. You could write appoint elders in every city, silence rebellious men. I think any of those two combinations really covers the chapter really well. So look at that. Heather, we get gold stars. We did that first thing off. Made Heather happy, so she loves it when we do a good chapter title. Okay, so we've already read verses 1-4. We've already heard how Paul describes himself. Let's stop just for a moment on Titus. Titus 1:4, let's just remind ourselves, how is Titus described?
My true child and my child. Common faith.
Okay, I only stop there for a moment because Paul's doing what he does a lot in these books is he's setting up a lot of contrasts. Lots of contrasts in Titus. We saw them in Timothy as well, but we see a lot of contrasts, and it starts right out here with him saying, Timothy, you are my true child. And then when you drop down later in the chapter, he identifies people who aren't. And keep this in mind, too. He's writing this about the church. So these are all conditions within the church. He's not talking about society. He's not saying, Timothy on Crete, you're my true child, but lots of people on Crete aren't. He's saying, Timothy, in the church, you're my true child, but in the church, there are many who are not. That's a sobering reality. But it's an important context I think we keep in front of us. So Timothy was his true child in the faith, as opposed to those who say they know God but really don't. Okay, let's drop down to 5. And we have the two instructions for Titus. Sorry, I said Timothy, didn't I? Oops. Okay, so the first instruction for Titus. Gosh, this is going to be hard.
Set in order.
Set in order what remains, right?
Yeah, the things that are lacking and appoint elders in every city.
What remains? Strange little phrase, but I like some other translations do it better. And appoint elders. In every city. Well, it's going to be, yes, in every city, but it's also going to be in every city where there's a church.
Oh, well, yeah.
I mean, that's just an assumption. Right. The church has to be there first, and yes, but there it goes. Okay, appoint elders in every city where there was a church. And so 5 then flows into verse 6, right? So 6 says, namely, if any man be above reproach, husband of one wife, having children who believe, not accused of dissipation or rebellion. How did 5 flow into 6? What is 6 describing?
Qualifications
for
an elder.
Okay, so this is so practical, right? He doesn't waste any time. He's like, appoint elders, verse 6, namely, they need to look like this. And of course, when we do a more in-depth study, we'll spend some time together. But I want to drop down to 9, because 9 has a repeated idea that's really important. It says, these same elders are supposed to hold fast the faithful word, which is in accordance with the teaching, that he may be able to exhort in sound doctrine and refute those who contradict. I think this is a big idea in this book. So, he said that these elders need to be able to exhort with what?
Sound doctrine.
Okay. And they're supposed to be able to refute, right?
Uh-huh.
Refute what?
Those who contradict.
Okay. Let's take a moment in your lesson. They were easy on us. They didn't have us do the word study, but they did it for us, which was really, really nice. So let's look at the definitions for sound and the definitions for doctrine in your homework. So the definition for sound is what? What do you see about sound?
Whole or healthy.
Yeah, I like that. Sound is whole and healthy. I think of boats. I don't know why I think of boats. When we talk about, is it sound? Like, is it going to not take on water? Is it not going to sink in the middle of the lake or the ocean?
Are true.
Like, huh?
Are true.
Or are true?
True doctrine.
Yeah.
Like
so
that solid rock the Bible also talks about. Stand on the solid
rock. So it's solid. It's true. I like it's whole. It's not broken in some place.
Mm-hmm.
It's healthy as opposed to unhealthy. And so he said, so sound, and then doctrine, what is doctrine? What did you find out? What does doctrine mean?
The teaching.
Yeah. Teaching, another word is instruction. And instruction, not the verb, well, it could be the verb, but in this case, it would be instruction, like the content of it, right? And another word, I like this, precepts, our doctrine. It's another word you could use there. So he says these elders are supposed to exhort with sound doctrine. So in your own words, what's sound doctrine? For these elders, what are they supposed to be able to do?
Use the word of God.
Use the word of God, but I would say how. Preach
truth.
Uh-huh. Yeah, a lot of truth. What does it mean to exhort? Is someone joining us? Crystal.
Yeah, sorry.
That's okay.
Exhort, they should, like, display, that's how they should present themselves,
like,
right?
They themselves need to have sound doctrine, or?
Well, they should live that way.
Uh-huh.
Well, I don't know how I'm trying to say it. Next.
I think what you said was good, Crystal, because you said they're supposed to live it, and then I look at 6, 7, and 8, right,
uh-huh.
In chapter 1, and that's absolutely how do you live that sound doctrine, and then it's saying not only do they live it, but they also need to have an ability to teach it,
mm-hmm.
and to use it when they're speaking to one another, and to when they correct someone, they need to be able to use this whole and healthy instruction. but there aren't holes in it. I mean, it's a pretty tall order for these elders, what they are supposed to be doing. So keep the idea of sound doctrine in front of you, because when you went through and marked that word, so on your little at-a-glance sheet, you could add that. It's one of the key words. In almost every chapter, you find sound or you find doctrine, right? And so it's something that's really important to Paul, and he's using that as a point of instruction. Okay, let's go on to verses 10 to 16. So we have the elders that were just described in 6 to 9, right? So we just heard about those elders he's supposed to appoint. And now you get down to verse 10, and you get a contrast. Here's one of the contrasts. You've got the elders, but then you also have this other group of people. And who are they?
Rebellious
men. And he also uses some other adjectives to describe that. Not just rebellious men, they're also what?
Empty talkers.
Deceivers.
Oh, especially those of the circumcision.
So that tells you a lot of them happen to be
Jewish. How many times I read this and I just kind of like, boom, it hit me right there.
Right? It's always fun when those things happen. So some of them happen to be Jewish, right? Not all of them, but many of them are the circumcision. So they're talking. But what they're saying is not true.
They're having pretty wide influence, too.
Yes, because according to verse 11.
Upsetting whole families.
Right. And these aren't just like, I would think a lot of these are big family groups, right? Mm-hmm. So whatever they're saying is upsetting whole families. They're teaching what they should not teach. What's their motivation? That's the end of verse 11.
Sordid gain.
What does that mean?
Yeah, they get paybacks.
Mm-hmm.
They probably tried to advance their own wiseness.
It's benefiting themselves.
Yep.
And it's in contrast to Paul, who says, I'm a bondservant of whom?
Jesus Christ.
So what I do is gain for Jesus. And he's contrasting it with these men who, whatever they're saying, the gain is to themselves. It isn't about Jesus. Now, with their mouth, they might be saying they're serving Jesus, but the content is not. Okay, verse 12 we're not going to hit because, like I said, this is just an overview. We'll go back to that wonderful statement about Cretans. In verse 13, when Paul says his testimony is true. But in 13, what does he tell Titus? What is Titus supposed to be doing? Ooh. Reprove them severely.
Sharply.
Mine says rebuke.
We looked at that, didn't we? What does it mean to rebuke? Wag your finger at them?
Tell them they're wrong.
It's pretty strong, right?
It's
like you are wrong, and I'm pointing it out to you. So reprove them severely. That they maybe, and then you see the desire is that they do become, there's that word again, sound, whole and healthy in the faith. They need to be shown where they are wrong. Okay. And then we have 14 and 15 and 16. We've got more on these rebellious men. Verse 16, we have another word.
It also seems...
Oh, go ahead.
So, pretty... In 14...
Uh-huh.
The Jewish are still going by old ways.
Okay, yes. So you see that, and that adds to the historical context of that church, right? Mm-hmm. So this is a church where some people that are in it are still saying that you have to obey the Jewish law. That's not uncommon in these early churches, but yes, that's something else that he's contending with. Is that what's upsetting whole families? You know, are they going to whole families and say, you can't eat that pig anymore? And entire families are like, well, what do we eat? Yeah. It could be as simple as that.
Well, one of the commentary I read about Titus said that he was a Gentile, which Paul intentionally did not have circumcised.
Oh.
Did not have what?
Did not have him circumcised.
Why?
Oh.
It didn't go on and say, but okay. I think... Maybe we see here some evidence of why, so that he doesn't fall into those old Jewish ways, and that's the way it has to be.
Oh. Yeah.
But
that
Timothy,
makes a statement. Timothy, he did have circumcised.
Sight, right.
But he was half Jewish.
But yes, he was also half Jewish.
Right.
So
Titus was a Gentile, right?
And that's what they believe.
So if I believe he's a Gentile and you're doing teaching,
yes,
you get circumcised, so then I'm going to think every Gentile needs to be.
Right. I think to my dad's point, he's trying not to confuse people.
Right. Right.
Because then would Paul be inadvertently saying that I think you need to follow all the laws,
yes,
which
right.
he didn't.
Which would bring us back to the Jewish
myth.
Right.
Right.
Yes.
Myths and the genealogies and all of that. Absolutely. Absolutely. So good insight. So I want to go to verse 16 because I want to hit one other key word. And the key word in 16 is, y'all know what it is.
Deeds.
Look at this. You already know what your key words are for the book. But it's deeds. And deeds just simply mean a work or an act. Okay. So let's read 16 just for a moment and find out, you know, what this has to do with the entirety of the book of Titus. Okay. So we're talking about the rebellious men in verse 16, right? And this is, I think it's a key thought or idea. This is so sobering to me, again, because we're talking about within the church, there are rebellious men, and Paul in 16 says, they profess to know God. So they will stand up next to you and say, yes, I believe in God, I believe in Jesus Christ, but by their deeds they deny him, being detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. So, what did that just tell us about deeds? What do deeds do, according to verse 16? Make sense?
Well, they deny God.
Say again, Crystal?
They deny God.
They deny God. Okay, so that means the things that I do, the work that I do,
right,
can actually deny God. How? What is that verse? That verse also gives you some other hints.
Well, they're not doing what they're preaching.
Yeah. You're not doing what they're detestable. It's disobedience. It isn't following sound doctrine, right? It's doing things for my gain, right? And so he's saying you can say one thing, but the work of your hands, what you do with your time, your actions, can actually prove completely otherwise.
I guess that's where follow what you preach comes from.
Yes.
Yep. Well, that's in the church when you have a homosexual pastor, and you know, they're preaching the word of God, but yet they are living a life.
And you could just take that and go, yes, in so many ways. It's like, watch what they do, and doesn't Kay say that? Let me watch how you live, and I can tell you what your doctrine is.
But that goes back to what Paul said to Timothy.
Which is
at the end closer to the end of our lesson in Timothy 2. Remember, Paul kept stressing to Timothy that what they say may not be what they're doing.
Right. Right.
So he's telling Titus
the same thing.
The same thing.
And so he's telling us the same thing.
Actions do matter.
Actions matter a lot. And that it's sometimes way too easy within a church body to just say, sure, I can read, you know, that statement of faith with you. I agree with that. But if their life is lived contrary, the call to Titus, the call to us is to say, wait a minute, this is not a follower of God. It's hard, right? So let's keep moving forward, because this does get to be a very, very practical book. You know, what is our call? How do we live in light of this? Okay, first chapter 2, verse 1. The chapter, it starts out with a wonderful word, but. Okay, so he just got done describing rebellious men, and now he says, but as for you, Titus, speak the things which are fitting for sound doctrine. So in this chapter, you're going to see doctrine three times. You're going to see the word deeds three times. So I think that makes it really easy to come up with a chapter theme or a title for it. I think it's really easy to take the word doctrine and the word deeds and turn it into a chapter title. So, first of all, let's do doctrine. What does he say about doctrine in this chapter? He just read it.
Sound doctrine.
Do what with it?
Speak it.
Speak it and teach it. So I think that can definitely be part of your title. Speak sound doctrine, right? And then the second question is, what about deeds? Look at verse 7. Look at, 14. What do you learn about deeds?
Just what you said. Practice what you preach.
Practice what you preach. Yeah, that'd be great. I mean, that could be one. If we're going to use the words that are used within the chapter, what does it say about deeds? It says, be an example of good deeds, right? So, both, not either or, it's both. Teach sound doctrine, but also do good deeds. And the two go hand in hand. The two make a leader that the people then can follow, right? Okay, so I think that's a good chapter title. Speak things fitting sound doctrine and be an example of good deeds. Okay, we looked at the contrast for in verse 1, that Titus is to actually be speaking sound doctrine, not things that upset whole families, not teaching that's contrary to the word of God, not about genealogies and myths. Speak sound doctrine. But look down to verse 15 also. I want to see it bookends this chapter, right? 15 says, these things speak and exhort and reprove with all authority. And I like the last little phrase. Let no one disregard you. So let's just stop just for a minute. Why do you think Paul threw that in there? Let no one disregard you. So what does it tell you might have been happening?
I think that if he didn't follow what Paul was telling him,
uh-huh,
he may lose the respect.
Oh, okay. Nice point. So Nivea brings up, like, if Titus didn't follow through, he'd lose the respect of the people that he's trying to work with. There is that. Absolutely.
That would be a disregard,
but what else?
They're blowing him off.
Yes. So, Crystal, you're on to something, too. Could these bodies, these new churches,
mm-hmm,
have the tendency to blow Titus off?
Because he must be a young man.
And I think this chapter shows us he probably is also a young man, like Timothy was. So he had age working against him.
Do you think a Gentile? Do you think that had anything to do with it?
Those are all great questions. Is it also because he was a Gentile? Because the people, at least it sounds like, not all of them, but it sounds like probably a majority of those rebellious men are Jews. So yes, are they looking at Titus as a Gentile and going, well, you have no right to talk to us. You're not even of God's original chosen people. You don't know about our history. You don't know, is that going on? And Paul is saying, don't let them disregard you. Well, then I have to stop and go, how do you stop someone from disregarding you?
Confront.
Confront? Okay, yes. Is that where the reproving comes in?
Uh-huh. Yes.
I'm like, get a bigger microphone.
Paul strongly wanted Titus to confront those people.
Yeah, so I think that's key, Leslie. It goes back and it's using what we just read. Yeah, you need to confront those people. What else?
It's racism in God's word.
You have to do it with God's word, so sound doctrine.
And the teachings of Jesus now, I don't think they have that yet.
Well, they
need to know God, Jesus.
Probably not in the way we know them, but they have record of Jesus and his teachings.
I think there's a little bit of, okay, Paul was here, he left.
Mm-hmm.
Who are you to take over?
Could it be? Yes.
Diana.
Right. Oh, Diana.
Verse 8, though, he also says, your deeds and your speech, which is beyond reproach, so that the opponent will be put to shame, having nothing bad to say about it. So your
right.
speech being above reproach and your deeds go back to them not being able to disregard, I think.
Yes. So, I mean, they could not listen, but they can't come against it, right? If my words and your words match your deeds and they line up with Scripture, like, no one's going to be able to really bring a case against you. Right? Kristen.
The other thing that Titus had going against him in this context was he was not circumcised. And I just re-looked it up to make sure I wasn't mistaken. So Paul didn't have him circumcised like he did Timothy. So
right.
they really could have been looking at him
Yeah.
An outsider.
Yeah, a little bit of racism even. I mean, that's why I call it, you know, racism. I mean, you see that with Cretans, you see that with Jews, and now you have this Gentile. It's so interesting to take all this and then layer what you know from the book of Romans. Some of you did the study of Romans with us, and that was a huge issue that Paul was confronting in Romans, is how do these Jews and Gentiles now live together? And how do you not think poorly of one another because of your background? How do you confront
them? You know, I've, like, looking at today's world.
Yes.
And how difficult it is,
uh-huh.
even today. You know, that last verse, when he says reprove with all authority, I just wonder how it was for him.
Yeah.
You know, trying to do that at that time.
Right.
Because I don't see it now, you know. People try to do it, and it's just so much chaos.
It is so much chaos. We as a society, like, are very distrusting,
mm-hmm.
and we don't give many people authority. We question it. Lindy.
I think he's suggesting some persistence here.
Yes.
Do the things, exhort and reprove and all that, but then if they disregard you, keep on saying it, which is where I kind of back down too much in our culture where it's so hostile, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay, you don't want to follow me.
Yeah, I shake the dust off my feet and my hands and bye, and maybe there's a call for persistence. Really good. Let's go back, because we just hit the first and the last verse, and we aren't, like I said, because it's overview, we're not going to go into detail, but I do want to keep building this context, like what is going on in the church. And we hit on it a little bit earlier, but I'm going to erase our word studies because we don't need them. But he lists a lot of different people groups within the church in chapter 2, and he's got very specific instructions for all of them. So this is also what he's supposed to be doing. So 2:1 starts, speak the things which are fitting for sound doctrine. And then he begins to list. So for the first people group he mentions in verse 2, and it's who?
Old men.
Older men. Older men. Now we don't have to go over all the instructions for the older men, but what seems to be key for older men? There's the word sound again, right? So when I see sound in Titus, I'm going to be like, oh, I'm going to pay a little bit of attention to that. So it's sound is whole and healthy. So what are the older men to be sound about?
Faith.
What's supposed to be sound?
Faith.
Huh?
Faith.
So their faith is supposed to be whole and healthy. Any other key thoughts for older men?
Temperate.
Dignified.
Sensible.
Okay, it's building. Are you getting like this picture? So what's it supposed to look like? What's his desire for the older men?
Gentle. To be leaders.
Gentle, to be leaders.
Respectable.
Respectable, we might say. Kind of to have some, like, know the situation you're in and act appropriately.
Yeah.
Right? So all those things are in there. I like the idea of sensible is also self-controlled. So just to be self-controlled and sound in faith. I like that. I'm not saying it's the most important, but just because sound is used, so.
My Bible says 50. They gave him an age.
I was wondering what the age would have been. 50. Wow. Older men are 50 and older.
Yeah.
I know. Wow. Right? So.
In a footnote?
Oh, my gosh.
Huh? Is that in a footnote? It's in my footnote. It says that they, back then in Creed, older men were classified 50.
Kind of interesting. Well, life expectancy. The other thing is some of it, well, that's for Timothy, how we kind of, I think how a lot of people try to figure out how old Timothy is they think of younger, and a lot of times younger also in the Roman world was like the age at which you would serve in the army.
Yeah,
like the age at which they would consider you too old to do something or too young, and sometimes that's where they get those guidelines. If you're wondering how they come up with 50,
yeah.
It might have something to do with
and
that.
And the same was for women.
Right.
My Bible also said the same was for women.
The women, older women are over 50? Okay. whatever. We're not talking about it.
It says
that hurt.
It does hurt, doesn't it, Crystal? And it's cruel.
Yeah, it does.
It
cruel.
Hurt.
55.
Right? men, but who else is mentioned in three?
Older women.
And then we've got younger women. So hold on just a second. Let's go back to older women, and then we've got younger women. Older women, kind of a key thought for them. What do you think?
We can't gossip anymore.
Dang it. Reverent in their behavior, and I feel like that reverent in behavior is then the list following it, right? To be reverent is to not gossip maliciously. Yeah, to not drink too much, to not to teach what is good. And then we've got the younger women in there, right? Mm-hmm. And what's important for the younger women?
Just love.
Just love your husband. Love your kids. Yeah. Right? But we got
and
verse
be
5.
Sensible and pure.
Sensible is used several times, is it not? Mm-hmm. Self-control. That idea. So, stepping back, think about the society. What might it be saying about the society if the reminder to be sensible keeps showing up? What might they be like? Hedonistic?
Living whichever way they want to live.
You live however you want. Might it be hedonistic?
Yeah.
Might it be just like drink a lot, do a lot of this, a lot of excessive living? Does that make sense? Excessive? Yeah? Just, you know, yell, scream, do whatever. Okay.
Bar hopping.
Huh? Bar hopping? Yeah. Is there bar hopping going on? Are the women like is it a temptation to just go out and do whatever you want and ignore your home life?
That's what it sounds like because he's instructing to young women to love their husband.
To like stay home, take care of your home. So the other side is might they not be doing
subject
it
to your own husband?
That's
right.
So when you're saying love your husband, it says being subject
to your
own
husband. Just like the overseers are to be the husband to how many wives?
Yeah.
So might there be a lot of just, is adultery accepted? Sleeping with whoever you want because it's fun? And instead the call of sound doctrine is you've made a covenant to your spouse. You uphold that. So all these things, there's just things to ponder about what might be going on in the society. Okay. So there's younger women. The next group of people starts in verse 6, and who is it?
Young
and young men are to be what?
Sensible.
Dear me. So much sensible living called for here, huh? Be sensible. Young men, to be sensible in all things, show yourself to be an example of, and here's one of our repeated words, an example of what?
Good works.
Good deeds. Here's another one of our words. With purity and
doctrine,
dignified. There's another one of our words.
Sound,
so whole and healthy in your speech. And he kind of further defines it, which should be beyond reproach, in order that the opponent may be put to shame, having nothing bad to say about us. Now, go back to verse 7. I do want to show us this. In verse 7, if you went through and marked Titus, you probably put a mark in verse 7, did you?
Yes.
For yourself. So yourself, Titus, ends up in the description of what people group?
Young men.
So I just want you to see that's why a lot of people think that he was probably a young man, because he ends up in that description of young men and what young men are like, which is interesting because there's the call again to be sound in doctrine and pure in deeds. And we know that that's definitely the call for Titus. Okay. 9 and 10, another people group is
bond slaves.
Bond slaves, I know we've talked about, is like a subgroup in slaves, and they're the ones. I don't know if it's true here. It might very well be, but a bond slave tends to be someone that says, I choose to be a slave to this person for the entirety of my life. Like, I'm choosing that way of life. It's not that it's against their will. It's someone that has chosen to do it. And so, obviously, he's got bond slaves within this church, and what's their call? What's the big thing for them?
Not argumentative.
And subject their own masters.
Okay, so I think that's like the big call. Be subject to your masters. Again, we've talked about this in other books where you see slavery brought up in these churches. So you have to ask yourself, do these slaves, once they come to Christ and say, well, I serve Christ, master, I no longer need to serve you. And in fact, I'm going to spend all my time telling you how you are not a good person because now I'm a Christian. And the call is contrary. It is to go home, be subject to your master. Don't argue, right? Please that master. Not pilfering. What does it mean to pilfer?
Steal.
Don't take what's not yours, right? Showing all good faith that they may adorn the what? There's our repeated word again.
Doctrine.
Of God our Savior in every respect. So there's the tie-in with deeds and doctrine, right? If you're acting in a godly way, then it shows your doctrine to be true. And those two are tied together. That's a huge idea in this book, is how deeds and doctrine go hand in hand. And we'll spend some time just keep on fleshing that out. Okay. That is 9 and 10. All right, stopping there. Obviously, I mean, sensible shows up all over. Sound, sensible, deeds are all in there. Sensible. Did I spell that right?
Yep.
Okay. These are all just repeated. The call for all these people group is related to that. I mean, how it plays out within each group is subject to, like, what is their life circumstance. But for you and I, let's just take a moment. What's an application for us just looking at these people groups? Is the call for them back in Crete the same as the call for us?
Yeah.
In what ways?
Christian living,
how does it matter? Does it matter?
Be an example.
Be an example.
What we call witness.
Does the world seem to care how we live?
I think they watch.
Mm-hmm.
I do. They watch. We're more on display now with social media.
Yeah.
We are, aren't we?
Yeah. Yeah. I think they watch. And this is just my opinion. I don't think they care.
That's why I asked the question.
I think if this world was put into a Timothy Titus era, I don't think we could make it very well. I really don't. I really don't think that we could make it very well, because we look at things a little bit different than we feel more entitled.
We being Christians or all people?
I think there may be a little bit of both.
Okay. I think we have the Jewish attitude.
What is the Jewish attitude?
I'm the chosen one. I'm better than you.
Do we come across that way? That's a good question.
Yeah. Thank you, Blanche. That's a good one.
Yeah. I also think people
I'll get
who
your
are
name
searching.
Crystal, I see you.
Oh, okay.
I also think people who are searching for the answer and looking at Christianity, yes, they're listening very hard and watching very hard.
I mean, I'm with you, Kristen. I think we are on display and people are watching, but I think I hear a little of what you're saying too, Leslie. I wonder if the world's like, they don't matter because they never match up. What their deeds and their words don't match up, so we've become irrelevant because...
How are we any different than that?
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, Crystal. Crystal's been waiting. What do you have to say, Crystal?
Well, I think that one thing that goes through my mind a lot is that our society as a whole, to use the phrase politically correct, meaning that we soften everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that in the church we've done that somewhat too, to the point that sinful behavior or, you know, contradictory behavior, you know, it doesn't have an impact when we talk about it a lot of the time because we just soften it all.
Yeah.
I
think you're talking about tolerance of sin in the church.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you're starting to ask the question, do we tolerate? So going back to Titus and keeping context, I mean, he is addressing first and foremost the church and the people within the church and how are you acting, right? And are your sound doctrine and your deeds, do they line up or are you contradictory? And I think we're in this room saying when those things don't line up, when even in the church we aren't living it out, then outside the church, we certainly are going to have no witness, right? And that's the question, like, are we kind of at that place to, because, Crystal, for what you're saying, even within the church, we're not really clear on sound doctrine or deeds. Maybe we can speak a lot of sound doctrine in the church, but are our deeds lining up? And do we take that seriously with one another? I mean, that's, the call is to meddle with one another. I mean, Titus is being asked to meddle. He's being asked to go to people and say, your deeds don't match your words. We don't like to do that. And the question is it affecting our witness outside these doors? We aren't going to answer that question right now, but I think it's some of the issues that Titus can speak to for us. Dad, okay. You're giving me that look like.
Yeah, I guess I have a little bit of disagreement.
You can, I mean.
I think every president we've had, no matter what they discuss, has called upon Christian leaders and pastors to come and talk to them at the White House. I have, you know, I'm a good friend in South Africa, a pastor.
Yeah.
Who Nelson Mandela, when he had serious issues, would call him and ask him to come and counsel with him.
True.
So, yes, you and I, maybe some days we really feel we're not getting anywhere. But I guess what I'm feeling
are there
is
glimmers
the other
hope
side is there.
Yeah. Is there hope?
Yes.
Or, you know,
are they following those? Then I don't know the answer to that.
Right.
Or is it a facade?
Yeah, maybe. Could be.
A facade. Is it could be a
depending
facade,
on the president,
or
right?
Or is it whoever wants to make a platform for themselves to see this is, oh, yeah, this is how
yeah.
I am, but
yeah.
behind closed doors, this is really what
and
I'm
so
doing.
Maybe
no
what maybe
right.
what can be,
yeah.
maybe. At least for me, I mean, I keep getting hit with this, is for me, do I get too distracted with how does Christianity look to the secular world to the point that I forget about how are we doing just in the church? Mm-hmm. Are we protecting sound doctrine? Are we calling for godly deeds within the church? Or are we getting so distracted by everything outside that we're not taking care of it here? And then slowly but surely, we are eroding from the inside out to the point that maybe one day we have no witness. I just feel like this is to me personally, these Timothy and Titus are called to, wow, how are we doing inside these walls? And why does it matter? And how do you deal with those issues inside the wall? Because it's not easy. So, yes.
And that's where the sound doctrine has to be taught.
I like that. I like that. I like that statement. As we do, the outside culture does come in and affect us. And is it forcing us to say, ooh, we can't talk about this here because I know there's 10 people it would offend, so I'm not going to talk about it. But then is that even sound doctrine, right?
Right. Then we don't.
That's the slippery slope.
It is a slippery slope.
It's very slippery slope. And I so much agree with you. You know, I think most of you guys know I work twice a day,
right.
twice a week in the church office. And I answer the phones. And three times last week, I mean, I had to just sit and listen. But it was amazing. Three times, three people have called up here at this church and wanted to and asked me hardcore strong questions. Yes. Oh yes. One lady chewed me
like
out.
On what we believe?
What we believe? Are we preaching from the pulpit about politics? Are we for
transfer to Cindy Palmer?
That's right.
No, maybe Cindy Palmer like has her there for a reason. Leslie, you take that call.
Are we talking Trump? Are we talking Biden?
Yeah.
Or are
wow.
we preaching the gospel? Are we is our pastors here in this church preaching the gospel that they do not want to come to a church that is trying to political views
yeah.
and what's going on and that QAnon and all that? And I don't even know what 30 minutes with that person. What was she talking about? And I said, I just was listening, and I just said that from my experience sitting here and coming to church regularly on Sunday, I have not heard my pastor or any of our other two talk anything politically out of the pulpit.
Yeah.
And this is the Methodist doctrine. And I was just like, Kathy goes, I'm so proud of you.
Well, I mean, it's not unlike, okay, so.
But it's,
yeah. Could the politics of today be the chapter 1, verses 10 and 11 of Titus's day, where people within the church insisted you had to be doing this or voting this or believing this, and it upset entire families? You know, is that where we feel like the culture is trying to push the church, become a political entity, or protect your country above what? You know, there's some hard things. And like I said, this book gets very, very practical. I'm thankful for it, but it is probably a couple times going to make me go, ouch. And that's okay. We need to go, ouch. Okay, let's move on because we need to finish this out. We're down on verse 11, and things are going to change. So we've had so far a listing of people groups. We've had instructions for them. The instructions seeming to line up around, you know, how do you act in a whole and healthy way? How do your deeds match your words? But now we get to 11, and 11 sounds different. It says, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires, to live sensibly, there it is again, righteously, godly, in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Christ Jesus, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself a people for his own possession, zealous for good deeds. These things speak and exhort and reprove with all authority. Let no one disregard you. So, what are these verses about? Starting in 11.
Salvation.
Yeah. So, it's been a long time. It's probably been over 10 years because I think I'm still at the Nazarene Church. I went to training for precepts, and it was like sentence diagramming. And we did it with the book of Titus. And I specifically remember getting to verse 11, you know, and having to line up the subject and the predicate and listing things out. But I have that ingrained in my brain. It's kind of fun to do, particularly with passages like 11 to 14. What is it teaching about the gospel? What is it saying? But you're right. So this, he stops and says, understand, here's the gospel. We're going to review it. What is it about? It's about the grace of God. All men can be saved. Verse 12, he says that salvation then instructs us to do what? Deny what?
Ungodliness.
And so it's going in with his theme, right? These actions, the grace of God says, forget those and instead do what?
Live sensibly.
There it is again. Live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age, right? Drop down to 14. I really like 14. I like it. It says, Christ Jesus gave himself for us, and here's deeds. Here's the contrast of deeds. That he redeems us from every what? So there's lawless deeds, and Jesus redeems us from them so that we can do what?
Good deeds.
Have good deeds. Godly deeds, right? And purify for himself a people for his own possession, zealous for good deeds. Okay.
And this is a critical call for us because
yes, it
it's
is.
A reminder it's as to why he gave himself to us.
Thank you, Nivia. That was beautifully stated.
That was.
That's right, really what he was doing. He's like, here's why Jesus gave himself for us. Not just so we have this new head knowledge, but because we live differently. And I think Paul would say if we're not living differently, we've got to ask, do we know God? Or are we those people that were described as 116, people that profess to know God, but our deeds deny him. Who, you know?
Because at the end of the day, will you give yourself to someone to redeem them or something?
Yeah.
You know?
Right. That's
huge.
It is huge. And what he went through in order to redeem us is huge. And he's worthy of us saying, okay, I'll deny that. Because I want to bring glory to you and honor to what you did for me. Yes, absolutely. Okay, good stuff. And then we see the instruction in 15. He says, these things, I think that whole chapter, right? That whole chapter. Speak it, exhort it, and reprove it with all authority. And by the way, don't let them disregard you. Chapter 3. Moving right along. We're doing pretty good.
That was just the overview.
That was just the overview, right? But it's good stuff, man. It is good stuff. Okay. So I think we can zoom through 3 a little bit faster. Here we go. What is this chapter about? If you are doing your keyword marking, what keyword did you have a bunch in this chapter?
Grace, deeds.
Yeah. Deeds is making it's showing itself again. I didn't see sound or doctrine anywhere. So this is a deed heavy, right? This is deed heavy. So let's read 3:1. Remind them. Who's them?
The Cretans.
The church there at Crete. Okay. Remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good deed. Eight. That they believed God may be careful to engage in good deeds. 14. Let our people also learn to engage in good deeds. So what might a theme for this chapter be?
Be ready for every good deed.
I like
which
that.
Is in verse
or
one.
Engage in good deeds. I think any of those.
For the church.
Yes, this is for the church. I did add in there, why did I add this? I think because I liked verse 8 a lot, and I did also write, speak confidently regarding the doctrine of salvation. And when we get down there, I think you'll see why. He does have several verses on Titus's call to speak about salvation. So if you have that about good deeds, engaging in good deeds, and then for Titus to speak about salvation, I think you're on the right track. Okay, let's work our way through. Verse 1 again says, remind them to be subject to...
Go ahead, do it. Okay. So in verse 1 and 2, we're talking just the church.
Yes.
Okay, because I don't know why I was thinking something else, because it says showing every consideration for all men.
Yes. So, let me read the 2, and then let's read verse 1 and 2, and let's ask about who is them, what's the call, how does it relate back to chapter 2. So let's do it. Remind them, and we're thinking the people in the church, the believers, to be subject to rulers, to authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good deed. To malign no one, to be uncontentious, to be gentle, showing every consideration for all men. You're asking a good question. So he's speaking to believers, and what is he telling them to do? He's saying, Titus, please remind them to do what?
Be nice to everybody.
Be nice to everybody. I like that.
Not just to be nice to everybody, but to be good citizens.
And I think that's where you're getting at, Nivea. There is a call to how do they act outside the church walls. And I think the call there is, you do have authorities. You need to be subject to them. You need to be considerate. There's a lot about all men. And we were just also told that, and this is 2:11, the grace of God brought salvation to all men. So if salvation is available to all men, how I act with all men matters. Because I want to be a witness to them. And I think he's saying, Titus, remind them that how you act, if you're polite, if you give them the respect due, it will only increase your witness. Does that help you, Nivea?
Yes.
Okay.
I think I'm a little confused because it says for you to be submissive and obedient to the authorities in the community.
Right.
I think my problem with that, the first part of this, is that some of those people that are authorities in the community are not really...
They're unsaved, I think.
Thank you. That's,
so,
yeah.
We'll get there, won't we, when we get to chapter 3? We'll get there. I think Jesus spoke some to this, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you're right. They're absolutely, Leslie and Nivea, you are getting to attention that we also live in. What happens when the society in which you live and your leaders, be they your boss,
yes,
right? Be it maybe a family member who's not a believer but is still, you know, someone you're close to, be they your government leaders, what happens when you know, they are living an ungodly life, and then I'm reading, I'm supposed to be subject and to be considerate. How does that play out? We're not going to answer that today, but it's a great question. I think Jesus has some help for us, and I think Paul will help us with it too. Okay, maybe verse 3 is part of it. It says, we were once foolish ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So how do you look at them in that case? Well, I once too. We were once foolish ourselves, disobedient, deceived, enslaved to various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in malice and envy, hateful, hating one another. But when the kindness of God our Savior and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, by the washing of regeneration, by the renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we might be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Wow. Okay, now, these verses 3-7 that I just read, they're different than 1 and 8-15. Here's a way I know, I hope you're doing this in your study, that you're underlining all the instructions to Titus. It's a really cool thing just to underline when you find a statement that's an instruction to Titus. If you do that, you see that 3 verse 1 has an instruction, remind them, right? 8 has an instruction, speak confidently. Every verse to the end has an instruction. However, 3-7 do not, which tells me 3-7 has a different purpose. It's not about giving an instruction. 3-7, then, what's the purpose of those verses?
Salvation.
Reminding them again of salvation. Reminding them of the eternal perspective of my life in Crete. Here's how it matters in God's economy, right? Here's what salvation is. Here's things I need to remember in my everyday life as I interact within my church with rebellious people and older women who might be gossiping and younger men who might not have great self-control. I need to remember 3-7. I know, 10's really good, right? We'll get there. We'll get there. We're getting there. So 3-7 is doctrine. So I think when Titus keeps being told, speak the words for sound doctrine, numerous times Paul goes, well, here's your doctrine. And 3-7 is your doctrine. So just like 2, we decided that 2:11-14 was doctrine. So he has doctrinal statements too. Okay. Verses 8-11, yeah, here it comes. 8-11, these verses are different. They're instructions. So 8 starts with, this is a trustworthy statement. And concerning these things, I want you to speak confidently. Tells you a little bit maybe about Titus, right? So that those who have believed God may be careful to engage in good deeds. These things are good and profitable for men. But, contrast. But shun what? Verse 9. Sounds like Timothy, right? Yeah, those words, right? Foolishness, wasteful things, right? Genealogy, strife, disputes about the law. They are and worthless. Paul feels really strongly, right? So he felt that way with Timothy too. And he's like, okay, shun those. What does it mean to shun something?
Mine says reject.
Reject, shun. You hear about it in the Amish communities, right? When someone like says, I no longer live that way, and you're supposed to be shunned. What does that mean? It's a little more than, it's rejection, but it's rejection with action. It's exile. So I see you in the grocery store. We don't even make eye contact because I'm shunning you, right?
You can't come to my house.
Your call comes up on my caller ID. I don't answer. I'm shunning you. Did Paul really tell Titus to shun those things?
Yes.
I mean, you can't argue with those words.
That
is what he says. And let's move forward. Verse 10. Reject who? And with conditions, reject a factious man. There's conditions. What's the condition? Meaning, you've already talked to them a couple times. We talked about that earlier. You know, the call is now, we need to talk. Yeah, 3 strikes are out. I think we get that from somewhere, right? Reject a factious man. Ouch. Why? Oh, verse 11. And he is self-condemned. I underlined this, like, and I was like, are these instructions for us? There are some things to be avoided and some people to be rejected. That's hard. And we're talking about in the church. Sometimes it's not hard outside the church, but this is in the church. There are some things to be avoided and some people to be rejected. We'll get there.
So can this be also applied to someone else's of a different faith in a different church?
Sure. So Nivy asked, can you apply this like outside the church? And I would say yes. Yes. I mean, I think we see examples of that in Jesus and his disciples when they're like, walk away from them, right?
Not to say that somebody else's church is better than my church or is not better than my church. I don't know if I made sense with
that.
No,
you did.
But just knowing that they are a church-going person who reads the Bible,
uh-huh,
and preaches.
If they profess to know God,
right.
But if their deeds and their teaching is contrary, I think you go, is this the time for Titus? If I've talked to them a couple times, is this the time to avoid them or reject them? I think these are the things we're going to wrestle with.
Yeah.
Like, not.
I know this may be getting too deep into it right now, but I just looked up factious.
Yes.
Because
thank you.
I wasn't quite sure what that meant. And
right.
It's a follower of false doctrine or a heretic. So that's a pretty strong,
yes,
word.
Right. Right. This isn't just, you know, they sinned once.
Right.
Right. This is their teaching to the point that I think going back to chapter one, it's upsetting people, and factious meaning it's going to cause people to say, I'm on that person's side and you're on this person's side. And yeah, we don't play with that.
And I think there's a difference between verse 9 and 10. We're to avoid,
yes,
what I might call false doctrine.
Yes.
But then 10 is, okay, when men have this, then you reject them.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Like false doctrine, like that, we don't play with that, right?
Right.
I make a strong stand that's false. We're not going to dispute it. I mean, we're not going to give any more time and attention. Yes. They're two different things. I mean, they can be connected, but they are two different things. Okay, let's move on and finish it out because we're in 12. Again, these become different than the rest of the letter. We just got instructions for those rebellious, those factious men, the false teaching. And then when we get to 12, we're changing the subject again. And he says, when I send Artemis or Tychius to you, make every effort to come to me at Nicopolis, for I have decided to spend the winter there. So what's going to happen in verses 12 to 15? If you were to group them under a heading, what would you say is going on here?
Travel plans.
Travel plans. Greetings, his little to-do list, right? So you hear about two people that are being sent to him, right? And when those people get there, then he says, Titus, I want you to come to me. Where is he?
Nicopolis.
Nicopolis.
It's between the two.
I don't know that I know exactly where that's at.
I do.
Oh, I do. It's north of Corinth.
On the
east coast of the Aegean
Sea. It's in today's Albania.
Okay.
So, this was before he went back to Rome.
Yeah, so this is right before his final imprisonment.
Oh.
Yep. Between the two imprisonments.
So he's getting close. He's
so
getting close.
Did this letter come after Timothy? Because when he was in
prison. It comes between 1st and 2nd Timothy, we believe. We believe it comes between 1st, but they're all pretty close together. I mean, there's not a lot of years difference between
them. Well, I thought he was in prison the whole time that he was writing to Timothy, first and second time.
No, I think this is the second time. Okay, you're gonna make me question myself, but I can check my work.
Okay.
Okay, so there's some travel plans. Verse 13, diligently help Zenas the lawyer and Apollos on their way so that nothing is lacking for them. And let our people also learn to engage in good deeds to meet pressing needs that they may not be unfruitful. So you see a call on the church. He's like, here is an example of a good deed. What's something the church could do that would be a good deed? What does
help
he say?
Help the travelers.
Help the missionaries.
Yeah.
They're probably missionary types. They're probably helping to further the cause of Christ. I mean, obviously help other people, but here I think it's very specific. meet their needs. Make sure they aren't lacking anything, right? That's 13. Help them on their way so that nothing is lacking. Make it easier for them to continue on their journey. Our church does a really great job of that, with missionaries in particular. I think our church is really good at saying, hey, if you have a need, let us know, and we will try to supply it. We don't want missionaries to be hindered by everyday needs. We want them to be able to focus on. So there's that. Verse 14, I think he's saying that all will help Christians learn to engage in good deeds to meet pressing needs. And then verse 15, we're at the end, says, all who are with me greet you and greet those who love us in the faith. Grace be with you all. So, in our last few minutes, that's the book. That's an overview. But I love this short little book because I think it would be pretty easy to come up with a summary of the book. So what you do is you take your themes for the chapters, right? Think about those key words and go, what's a nice summary for the book? Titus is about, anyone want to take a stab? Even you on Zoom.
Organizing the church in good faith.
Ooh, organizing the church in good faith. I like that.
Fitting for sound doctrine and good deeds.
Yeah, I think we're all getting, like, something with sound doctrine and good deeds have to be in there, right?
So I put verse 2:7, show yourself to be an example of good deeds with purity and doctrine.
Yes, so, yeah, Kristen's doing really good things. A lot of times, but if you can, to find a verse, if you can find a purpose verse, if you can find a nice summary verse within a verse, and I like that one, and I know why you did it, because it's got deeds and doctrine.
What verse was that?
That's 2:7. In all things, show yourself to be an example of good deeds with purity and doctrine. Now, that's very personal for him and how he acts, but we can take those ideas and say he also needs to teach those things.
Now that I know that I'm not categorized as young, but older.
Ouch. Let's see. Other examples of good verses. 2:1 is a great verse to take 2:1 as a Titus. You, Titus, speak the things which are fitting for sound doctrine, combined with maybe 3:8. Speak confidently, something about speaking confidently, the sound doctrine. Maybe with 14, teach the people to engage in good work. So Titus, speak confidently, sound doctrine, and teach people to engage in good works. That could be a summary. Kind of getting long. Any combination of those. I think those are good. Another great verse is...
How about knowledge of the truth, which is according to godliness?
What verse is that?
1:1.
Mm-hmm.
Titus 1.
Mm-hmm. I like Titus 1:5. I like Titus 1:5. I mean, I get hung up on summary, theme, and purpose.
Yeah.
Right? So 1:5 might be a good, like, purpose verse, because he literally is saying, I'm writing to you to tell you this, right? The summary of that might be, how do you do that? Well, you speak sound doctrine and engage good deeds. Any combination of those. So that's good. So in the end, why is Titus written? Why was Titus written? Thinking everything you're thinking, to establish a church. Why else?
Encourage Titus.
To encourage Titus. Mm-hmm. To encourage Titus in establishing a church. Mm-hmm. Why was it kept in our Bible? Like, I'm getting at, why is it here for you and I in 2021?
Well, the importance of sound doctrine and good deeds, mm-hmm. that they go together. It's not an isolation of...
Yes. It's kind of like the whole James thing, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, how do deeds and your confession of faith work together? Can you have one without the other? It's in that vein as well. And how does it affect a church if that gets out of balance? And how do you correct it? Right? I think all those things we need so desperately. We need so desperately. Yes.
If you don't have sound doctrine and good deeds, you're not on
do. I mean, and we know, we even know that statistically. I find it fascinating that churches that, I mean, again, this is not a political statement. I think it's just what people have studied. The churches that have sacrificed sound doctrine, the churches that have said doctrine doesn't really matter so much, it's just are we kind and loving, those churches that have moved in that direction statistically die at a high rate. The people quit coming because they have no foundation. Like, then what makes me different than anyone else? So, like, we know that. And however, the temptation is still there, right, within the church. I think
especially when we have a relationship Christians and our surrounding areas, it becomes complex.
It does. And I think we see that in Crete. And I think when we dig down in Crete, we're going to find a society not unlike ours, a society full of people that were like, if you like it, do it, and do it a lot. And an entitled society. I mean, there's stuff in there about laziness, right? All of that. So an entitled society that does affect the church. I mean, Lindy said it. When we as a church, those things do come in and cause us to go, well, we can't be too strong on that either. And so how do we stay sound in our doctrine when outside these walls we're feeling a lot of pressure to not? I mean, they lived it, we live it. And so how do we deal with it? So I think that's why it's kept for us. And I think it's worthy of our study. Y'all were great.
And I think Titus was really good because it kind of like summarized everything.
Yes, I like how neat it is. Mm-hmm. So like
he
I said.
More succinct in his letter.
He does. But as he gets to the end of his life, he gets really succinct, does he not? And like I said, like a few years ago when I did that class where we, it wasn't called sentence diagramming. I mean, they called it something else. But when I did that, I remember we did it in a day. And literally, we rewrote this whole book and like did it like sentence diagramming. It was a challenge. However, at the end of the day, I remember being like, I love this book. This is so practical. I remember being like, I didn't know things got so practical. And I was like, I can't wait to one day, you know, teach it. And it's been a while, but I was reminded why I love Titus so much. It's a really just clear, like, you don't have to read between lines too much here. It's pretty clear what he thinks. So, okay, 11 o'clock, so we need to go and start our video. And next week we will do lesson two, and I will probably have those mark books ordered. Go ahead, Lindy. Did you have a question?
Sorry, I've been on texting this morning, but the volume went to the end of Jesus.
Oh, she did? When?
Early this morning.
Oh. So last night, I just had that thought as they were sharing last night at church council. I'm like, she's not that far. Let's pray. Let's pray for Amalia and Chris and any of you want to pray? I mean, I don't need to do all
the
praying.
I would like to say a prayer. Add my friend Yvonne in there, her mom. Last Wednesday when I was here, I know that she was in hospice with her mom. And I told her that I would be available. And she texted me during class, but I was so into here.
Yeah.
Like, I caught it, like, later.
Yeah.
And it bothered me because I should have never had said. But she's like, not a worry.
Yeah. Is anyone else want to pray for? I mean, I can close this up. Does anyone want to pray for? Let's just start praying. If some people want to pray, we'll do that and I'll close it up. God, our hearts are heavy. We have known that Amalia was on her way to see you for a while, but it's a loss, and it's a hard loss, God. I lift up to you Chris and Gabby and Wyatt, who have been on this long journey for the past few years, and I know this last part has gone very quickly from having a mom who was present and able to talk to them to a mom who was so quickly incapacitated and is now in your hands. And I do thank you for that mercy, that the end of her life was not long, but yet we know the shock of that is hard. God, we just pray your mercy and your grace in that family as they begin this new chapter of their life. I pray for Chris, God, that he would just hold fast to you, that he would not be tempted to turn to the right or to the left or to isolate in his grief and his pain, but that he would easily see the way that he can rely on us, his faith community, to help him through, God. I pray for the following days as family gathers to remember her, that the planning will be easy, that it won't be contentious, that it'll be easy. And God, I pray for our larger church body. This is another big loss of someone in our midst who is young and who fought cancer. And God, it can be hard at these times to wonder where you are or what this means, or for us to get consumed in our grief. But God, we lay it before you, and we ask that you will sort out our hurt and our pain. We ask that you will give us the patience to wait on you in moments of silence and stillness, and just let you minister to us, to not cover up our hurt with busyness or avoidance, but we would truly let you come in and heal us and do a deeper work in our community, that we would be a place that helps one another through hard times, that we would not be afraid of these life circumstances, but we would know how to minister in them and bring health and wholeness. God, we want that for the Ayers family. We want them to be able to move toward health and wholeness after this. God, we love them, and we love you, and we trust you, even when sometimes it's hard to understand why. God, we know there are others in this room that also have loved ones and friends who are suffering in a very similar way. And we just pray over them as well. God, we love you. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you for telling us, Lindy.
Yeah.
Hard few weeks, isn't it? Or months. So.